Hi there, and welcome to Mr. Morgan's Math Help. This is Algebra 1, Unit 2, Lesson 11, our last lesson for this unit called Form Follows Function. So glad you've been joining us. Hope this has been helping you as you work through the unit. Again, your teachers are wonderful at what they're doing, so they've given you a lesson already for this one in class. And this is more just like a couple review notes as well as looking over your homework. So if you get stuck, you have some place to turn to look to figure out what you're doing, not just copy the answers, but to figure out some maybe some pointers and tips to help you get going in the right direction. Today's lesson really is more of a summary of all the things we've been talking about over the last unit. So you're putting everything together. So nothing really new here in this lesson at all. So the focus today is use different forms of linear and exponential functions to efficiently write equations, which is what we've been doing all along. Use the information given in different forms of equations to graph the functions. So we're going to be writing them, graphing them, and really we're trying to figure out what's the best equation to use, how do we tell which one to use, and how do we want to do that most efficiently. And that's the idea behind today's lesson. So this is a review. We've been talking about two different types of equations. We've been talking about linear and exponential. So beginning with the linear ones, first of all, we have three different examples of what those equations could look like. We have the slope-intercept form where y equals mx plus b, where m is the slope right here, and b is the y-intercept, which again means that's where it crosses the y-axis at. So the y-intercept is going to be the point right there where x equals 0, and y is going to be whatever it's going to be. Okay? Now, the point slope form is another one we've looked at as well, and that's when you have a point that's given to you, oftentimes an x1 and x2, and once you have a point, then we can use that x1 and y1 values and use them to create an equation using those as well as the slope value there. The other formula we looked at is the recursive formula, and that is when you're given an initial value of something, where they say we're going to start at a value where f of a or maybe f of a equals 1, and then when you know that, then you can have a recursive formula there. D becomes the constant difference in consecutive terms, and that's used for discrete functions, and that means it's going to be ones that's going to be more of a dot, right? It's not going to be continuous like a line or whatever. So discrete functions for recursive formula because you're looking for the next or the previous or the next value. So that's how that one works there. We also then, of course, have our exciting exponential functions. And these are the ones that I messed up a ton on when I was trying to figure them out. And part of the reason you mess up on them like I do is because there are different ways of writing the same equation. You can write it different ways and work with this, get the same solution. So sometimes I was finding ones that weren't what the answer key was saying, and then I would just confuse myself. So anyways, we first of all have the explicit form. Oops, and in the explicit form, what we're looking at here a lot of times is we have a y equals a times b to the x power. Okay, and a lot of times what's happening is this becomes our, if I remember right here, it's kind of our starting point. For one of the values we have and where we're starting at, this becomes our ratio there, and the x is just what we're going to be changing in our table, xy, to kind of work our way down. Okay, so let's say, for example, that this was a 1 and that was a 10, for example. We would say then that we know we're multiplying by 3, so the next would be 30, and we could put a 2 there. So does that work? It might work. Hard to say. Let's see. That becomes, well, technically it doesn't work. So ignore me. Once again, ignore me when it comes to those things. all right. Then we have our recursive formula. And the recursive formula is going to be also for the constant ratio between consecutive terms used for, once again, discrete functions there. Okay. So that's really the main stuff from today's lesson. And in today's lesson, then you had a series of probably about 8 or 9 different kind of stories or word problems that then you turned into equations, you graphed, and you solved. And that's the same thing you're going to be doing today with your homework. So hopefully you've already done your homework and you're here checking in to see if you got it right, if you're doing the right things and have the right steps. So let's take a look. Make sure you've done it first. You want to do your best in your homework problems first, and then you come back here to check your answers. All right, So let's take a look. Comparing different characteristics of each type of function, fill in the cells. So we have, first of all, y equals 4 plus 3x, and then we have y equals 4 times 3 to the x power. So for this one we would say is just basic linear growth. That's a linear function the way it's written, whereas this one has that exponent, so this is going to be exponential. What type of sequence corresponds to each model? Well, in terms of the sequence names, this is the arithmetic, and this is the geometric. To make a table of values, we would just come over here, x, y for the first one, and perhaps we just do the value 0, 1, 2, and 3. This will be our first one. So when x is 0, 3 times 0 is 0, and we're left with a 4. When x is 1, 3 times 1 is 3, 3 plus 4 is 7. And we know we have a constant rate of change here of plus 3, so we could also just say, well, I know I'm going to be adding 3, adding 3, adding 3, and that's my first one. To do the second one, 0, 1, 2, 3. When x equals 0 for the first one, this becomes 1, so we have 0, 4. When x is 1, 3 to the first power is 3. 4 times 3 is 12. And again, I know my ratio of change here is multiplying by 3, so I could write that there. So I know for 2, 12 times 3 is 36, and then 36 times 3 is going to be 108. Okay, so there's my table. Check, check. My rate of change for each of these ones here, for the linear one, we are adding 3. And for this one here, I know I am multiplying by 3. To graph each of those, they'll be a little different because one is linear and one is exponential, but you have your terms here and here. So for the first one, if I kind of mark out here 1, 2, 3, we know we're starting at 4 and going to 13. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. So we're starting at 1, 2, 3, 4. And at 1, we're at about 7. And at this one, we're going to be over here. This one, we're up here. And you get the idea. We're making a nice line like so. And then for the other one, we start at 0, 4. And then we go 1 up to 12. And then we go to 36. And then we go up here. So we're going to be curving that one like so. The y-intercept, remember the y-intercept is where x equals 0 is where the y-intercept is going to be. And so for the first one, the y-intercept is happening at 4. And for the other one, the y-intercept is also happening at 4. Okay, so those become characteristics of the different types of functions, just the basic way of looking at them. So the basic ones, for me, I'm usually okay. I think at this point, I feel confident in the linear ones. The exponential ones, I really have to think about a little more to figure out how to create that first one there. I guess I get a little confused because I know you can also do things like x minus 1 as part of what your exponent's going to be. So that's where I get a little stuck. But hopefully you can just do some testing of whatever you come up with and see if it works for you. All right, number 2. Find the y-intercepts of each of the following equations. Again, y-intercept means at x equals 0, what is y going to be? So here we would do 3 times 0 equals 0. So our y-intercept in this case is when x is 0, y is 0. That's our x and our y. Over here, we're going to do 3 to the 0 power, which happens to be 1. So when x is 0, y is 1. And those become our y-intercepts. How can you find the y-intercept of a linear equation, and how is that different from finding the y-intercept of an exponential equation? Well, with a linear equation, sometimes it's just clear because they give you it in a formula of like y equals mx plus b. And when they do that, we know that the b value is the y-intercept of a linear equation. With the exponential, We have to put the 0 in the place of x and then solve it. There's not a quick, simple way of figuring out what it is. You don't just see it. You actually have to work it out. So that's how that works. All right, now let's move on to the next thing. Decide which form of an equation will be the most efficient to use based on the given information. And you're gonna choose between slope-intercept form, point-slope form, and recursive form. Then if it's exponential, you might look at explicit or recursive forms. I'll tell you, when I was doing this, I probably am not always getting the most efficient one, so that's gonna be questionable. The main thing is making sure that you do get it. So for example, I really don't use a lot of the recursive, but I mean, I certainly could. I'm looking at it, now that I'm thinking about it, recursive one are gonna be more discrete things. So when you have a discrete type of function, those are the ones with the points, that's probably when I wanna go for the recursive. The other ones would work, but these are gonna give you more of a continuous equation. So Jasmine's been working a way to save money and wants to have an equation to model the amount of money in her bank account. She's been depositing $175 a month consistently. She doesn't remember how much money she deposited initially. However, in her last statement, she saw that her account had been open for 10 months and currently has $2,475 in it. Create an equation. Now, one thing right away that I noticed with this question and looking at my notes of what I'm talking about as well as what's going on here is that it's $175 a month consistently, which means she's not sometimes putting in 100 or a little more. It means that whatever she's doing the same amount, right? Where she's constantly adding the 175 and she's doing that every month, which means that that growth is going to be the same. But there's not going to be any values in between. So this really does become a discrete function. So because it's discrete, okay, and because it's discrete, we would say realistically that she might want to use a recursive one, possibly, okay? Because it could work. Now, in this case, we're going to go ahead and say that she also, we see we have the value at 10 months, it's at 10, 2,475. So for example, let's say this was 10. We have actually a point there that we could call 10,2475. So we have a point and we also have a rate. So you have to just decide what's the most efficient, and that's kind of the idea here. Again, if you come up with something different, that's totally fine. Not a problem at all. But in this case, depends on how you want to do it. I would probably choose myself the point slope form, because I use it more than recursive. I just don't go to the recursive very often, but you certainly could. So the point slope form would say that y is equal to our rate of change, which is 175 a month. We're going to multiply that by our first x value. Here's our x1, 10. Oh, sorry. I always do that backwards. We're going to multiply it by simply x minus our first x value, 10. And then we're going to add our first y value, 2,475. And that's it. So that becomes our equation for that problem. Okay, again, you could find another one. It just says most efficient, whatever makes sense to you. The idea is making sure you can figure out how to do it. Now, for the next one, we see that a table shows the number of rectangles created every time there's a fold made through the center paper. Use a table to find the answers for each question. All right, so we can see that we are multiplying by 2 consistently here. So we can tell already that it's going to be an exponential type of equation. We're using an exponent. So let's see what we have. Let's find the number of rectangles created with five folds. Which equation would you choose? All right, so we're just looking for the very next one for what would be next. I guess it depends on what you're looking at. The answer key for the teacher side says the easiest one to use here would be recursive. That'd be the recursive one, which kind of makes sense because you're just looking for the next one, Recursive is handy if you're looking for the next one or the previous one, just to figure out what that's going to be. You're not really going very far with it. So if you did recursive, then you would have an equation like f of n equals n minus 1 times what we're doing, the ratio, times 2. And we would say that we know that f of 1 equals 2. So as a result, then what would we do? Well, we'd plug it in and we'd say, well, this becomes like 5. And so 5 minus 1 is 4. And 4 times 2 is 8. And 4 times 2 is 8. And then we're at 8. What does that mean? I don't really know. So this is where I get stuck, because I don't really like this one. Like, I don't like it. Sorry. I prefer to look at this one and say, for this equation, I like to recognize that what's happening is we have our initial starting value of the 2. I know my rate is 2, so multiplying by 2. Then I need to figure out what goes here. What's my exponential stuff? So I look back and say, I want to, whatever the x is, I need to make sure that when I put in the value 1, I end up with a 2. So if I think about it, if I did 2 times 2 to the first power, that equals 4. So it doesn't work there. So I know it can't be just x. So if it's just x, it doesn't work. If I do x minus 1, then I would get 2 times 2 to the 1 minus 1 power, which is 0. And that becomes 2 times 1, which equals 2. So for me, that actually works just fine. So that's probably more of what I would use, right? I would look at that one. You could also just use f to the x equals 2 to the x power. Now, the reason that's the case is that when x is equal to 1, you get 2. When x is equal to 2, 2 squared is 4. So that works well too. And a lot of times you can see that one right away. I was just thinking more in terms of, you know, having that initial value, having my rate of change. So I'm looking at kind of the two parts. And that goes back to, I'm going to go back to your page, goes back to kind of our sample, right? Our sample here, which is y equals 4 times 3 to the x power. So in my head, I'm kind of locked into thinking about that model as what I'm looking for. So that's how I would look at it. So that's what I would do here. So on my solution, I put this as my answer there. For the one with 14 folds, I could use the same one, and I would still use the same one. Definitely on this one, I would use explicit. For myself, I use explicit here as well. So just giving a lot of information there, Noah, I'm sorry, but think of what makes sense for you and then test it out to see if it actually works. Number 6, a heavy punching bag contains 90 kilograms of sand and a small hole in the bottom, which means it's going to be decreasing. It loses 1.2 kilograms of sand every hour. Write an equation to model. Okay, so we know that we're talking about something that is, if we were to graph this, we're going to have a starting point of, let's say it starts here at 90, and it's going to be decreasing through time. What's nice is that we have this initial value of 0, 90 of where things would be beginning at. So for me, I could look at it there and say I have a y-intercept. So I would use the slope-intercept form here. I also know the rate of change at negative 1, 2. So this becomes an easy one to say, well, my rate is I'm losing 1.2 kilograms every hour times x, and I have a y-intercept that happens to start at 90. So that one's a lot easier just to write and just kind of, there it is, done. I like that. So yeah, I tell you, I like the linears much more than exponential. Just nicer to deal with. Since Scott started doing his workout plan, Jenna has been inspired to set herself a goal to do more exercise and walk a little more each day. She decided to walk 10 meters more every day. On day 20, she walked 800 meters. So what do we have there? We have a point, don't we? On day 20, She went 800 meters, so we have a point there. We also have a rate of 10 meters more every day. So in terms of what I would use, probably use the point slope form. And in terms of the equation, remember this is going to be y equals our rate times x minus x1 plus y1. And then we just plug those things in. So we're going to say y is going to equal 10 meters more times x minus our x value, 20, plus our y value, 800. All right, not bad. And one more. Okay, we have, oh, different question. For each question equation provided, state what information you see in the equation that will help you graph it and then actually graph it. All right, this comes back to me. It's exponential here. We have kind of our starting value here, or our y-intercept at 8. We have our ratio, which is going to be a half. So every number that comes after 8 is going to be half. So we're decreasing by a half. Or so, yeah, it's going to be getting kind of smaller. And so when we graph that out, I'm going to first of all make a little table. Tables always just help me make sure I'm going the right direction. Do you have to make a table? No, but it sure does help, right? If I know I'm starting at 8, okay, if I know I'm starting at 8, then I know I'm doing half of each one. So I'm going to do a 4, a 2, and a 1. If I continue that down, I'd be at a half over here. It just makes it easier to then come to the side and say, well, let's graph this out. And at 0, we're at 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. At 1, we're at 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. At 2, we're at 2. 1, we're at 1. And 3, we're at a half. So I have a nice little graph there. And we can see it's exponential again. So we're curving this down. And we get down. And we continue to curve and get close to 0, but never cross. All right. So works well. Again, this is back to that. I like that's just the setup. It just makes sense to me. The other ones, I mess up. Okay, hey, linear, yay! All right, linear. We also can see with this linear one that is also in point slope form. Okay, we can say it's in point slope form because we have this value and this value. We know that our slope is going to be 5. And because it's point slope form, we have a place where we're working. Now we know usually it's x minus x1 plus y1. Now, knowing that it's plus y1, we have a negative number there, it tells me something about what's happening, right? We have a point that's going to be at 2, comma, negative 6. So the tricky part here is just recognizing that if I'm looking for a minus value, okay, that stays there. I'm going to add a value. Now I'm adding a negative 6, so that becomes a minus 6. That's where you might have gotten tricked up at. So we have my rate here, my slope with 5. So same idea, I can graph that first. I'm going to make a little table, 0, 1, 2, 3. At 0, we are going to be, well, first of all, 2, we're going to be at minus 6. And I could either plug the values in and figure it out, or I could look at my rate. I know I'm adding 6 each time. So, or adding 5. Negative 5 plus, negative 6 plus 5 is a minus 1. If I go the other way, I'm subtracting 5. So this becomes minus 11 and minus 16. So now, graphing this out. So here we have 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, sorry, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Oops, I should have done this backwards. I'm looking at negative. Sorry. Let's try that over. So negative 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. All right. So at 0, we're going to be at negative 16. At 1, we're at negative 11, so we're here. At 2, we're at negative 6. At 3, we're at negative 1. Drop really down. All right, so we're going like so, and this is a linear one. So that becomes my graph for number 9. All right, number 10. Just solving each equation and then justifying your answer by identifying the property that you use. And this is our last little section for the day. They just want you to simply solve it and then decide what property you're going to use. Your options for property are going to be things like the division property of equality. You could have the addition property of equality. You could have a subtraction property of equality. And that's pretty much all we're gonna be looking at today. So solve them and then pick which one it is. So here, to get the x by itself, we divide both sides by 3. And x equals 15 divided by 3, which is 5. What are we doing? We're using the division property of equality. Here, x by itself, we're going to add 10, add 10 to both sides. That goes away, so x equals 12. What do we use? The addition property of equality. Here, I want to get x by itself, so I'll subtract 11, end up with a minus negative 27 equals x, and I am doing what? Subtraction property of equality. And same over here, minus 6, so x equals 4. We are using subtracted property of equality. Here we'll divide both sides by 6. 18 divided by 6 is 3. So the division property of equality. And then finally, one more time, we divide both sides by negative 3. So x equals negative 2/3. And again, the division property of equality. All right, that's really it for now. So hopefully that's making sense to you guys. That's it for this lesson and for this unit. Have a great day. I'm sure you have a test coming up. Do your best. I hope it goes well. And we'll see you next time for Unit 3.